Discussion on Holter monitoring. Holter monitoring is continuous monitoring and recording of two or more surface electrocardiographic leads in a solid state memory. Recordings on magnetic audio cassettes are now obsolete, and the recorders have solid state flash memory, so that the device size has also come down remarkably. The devices can record 24 to 48 hours of data from the electrocardiographic leads, usually attached on the subject's chest with disposable silver chloride electrodes. After completion of recording, the recording device is removed and the data downloaded into the Holter analyzer, usually a personal computer with appropriate hardware card and software installed. After analysis, the data can be reviewed and various arrhythmia detection templates checked for any errors in automatic analysis and corrections applied if needed. Continuous recordings with timing can be displayed in a full disclosure format, and the representative tracing clicked to enlarge for better analysis as shown in the image. Patient-triggered and automatically detected events can be checked and compared with the patient diary for correlation with symptoms. Holter is useful for documenting arrhythmias which occur daily, if it is not frequent enough to be captured by a single ECG. But less frequent occurrence of arrhythmia may need longer-term event monitors like external loop recorders or implantable loop recorders to document. While Holter records the given leads of ECG continuously, loop recorders record only the captured events, which can be done either manually using a programming wand or automatically by preset heart rate criteria. Polymorphic ventricular ectopic beats documented by Holter monitoring. A run of non-sustained ventricular tachycardia noted in a Holter recording. The tachycardia is followed by a pause and then a sinus beat and a VPC. The clinical setting was in a person with old inferior wall myocardial infarction with a chronic total occlusion of right coronary artery. The arrhythmia could be arising from the region of the left ventricular scar. The strip shown here has two channels showing couple of narrow QRS beats initially and three narrow QRS complexes at the end of the record. These are normal sinus beats marked N by the device with normal P waves, PR interval, QRS and T waves. In between, there is a run of wide QRS tachycardia marked as V by the device. Any wide QRS tachycardia is taken as ventricular tachycardia until proved otherwise. There is a short pause at the termination of the tachycardia before the sinus rhythm takes over. There is a little more irregularity in the tachycardia run than usual with ventricular tachycardias, which are fairly regular. Another possibility to be considered when there is an irregular wide QRS tachycardia is atrial fibrillation with ventricular pre-excitation, causing a wide QRS tachycardia. But it is very seldom self-limited like this, and ventricular rates tend to be higher. Moreover, there is no evidence of pre-excitation in sinus beats preceding or following the tachycardia. Artifacts are another possibility, though quite unlikely in this case, with a fairly good baseline and a pause when the tachycardia subsides. Artifacts are unlikely to have well-formed QRS and T-wave patterns as in this case.